As Christians, we are supposed to be in the world, but not of the world. But how do we determine between what the world calls freedom and authentic human freedom granted in Jesus Christ? We'll talk about that tonight, so please stay with us. Thank you, and welcome. I'm Father Mitch Paco, and welcome to EWTN Live, our chance to bring you guests from all over the world. Before we bring you our guests, I want to mention that today is the feast of St. Ambrose, who is a confessor and doctor of the church. He strongly defended the divinity of Christ against various Arian heretics. He also wrote very important books on theology and spirituality, especially his commentary on the Psalms. And he's very famous for being the bishop who helped the young Augustine to see that it was possible to be a Christian and have intellectual integrity. And then after Augustine was converted, he was baptized by St. Ambrose. So this is a great feast. Also, I want to mention something that's not as a joyful a feast, but today is also Pearl Harbor Day. And we want to remember all those who died, not only at Pearl Harbor, but throughout World War II that began that day. And in great gratitude for all the sacrifice, the people who were in the military and at home made in order to win that great victory. So let's pray for their souls and pray for peace so that there are no more such Pearl Harbors. Now, our guests tonight are co-hosts of a new EWTN television series that is in production this week. The series is called Authentically Free at Last. And they are here tonight to help us see the differences between the false freedoms sold to us by the culture and the true freedom bought for us by Jesus Christ. So please welcome Gloria Purvis, Damon Owens, and Deacon Harold Burke Sivers. Welcome. Welcome. Good to see you, Damon. Deacon. Good to see y'all.
Great to see you.
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank
it's
you.
Great to have you.
Thank
have you been having a good time doing this series?
Oh my gosh, a really good time. I love hanging out with these guys. They're the best. So
it's really good. That's great. That's great. Well, they've been saying the same kind things about you. So this is all working out. Great.
Yes, yes.
Now, the three of you are really well educated. You have this background that you bring to extremely important questions of what freedom really is. And this is one of the things that everybody who's been working on this series is so excited about, the insights that you're bringing into it. Gloria, let me ask you first, because you're sort of heading up this series.
Yes.
What is the thrust that you're trying to bring across?
Well, what we're trying to bring across to people is the difference between the counterfeit freedom that society says and the authentic freedom you find in Christ. Generally speaking, in society, we want people to understand that what is passed off as freedom is actually not freedom, it's license. And that will, choosing those evils actually is an abuse of freedom. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you choose truth, which is the person of Jesus Christ, that makes you free. Mm-hmm. And we also, the thrust of this is to help people with that basic understanding work through some of the modern challenges that are commonly presented as freedom today to people, like fornication, mm-hmm. contraception, and things like that.
Right. A lot of times what they're calling freedom are simply options that I want available to me anytime I choose.
Exactly.
And they don't pay attention to how this brings a lot of binding on them at the same time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Damon, what have you been contributing to this?
The best I can. Lori has such a wonderful idea, and it was really is a privilege to participate in this. As you know, the rich deposit of our faith is something that not only is meant to well up and to be part of our own formation and development, but the overflowing of that well in terms of evangelization and drawing people closer. So I think what was gifted about this series is not that we went through these major social evils, which is pretty simple to do. You can name them, you can point fingers to them, and we need to call them out and know what they are. But what's unique, I think, about the series is that first we laid this foundation of a lived understanding of some of these principles, like what is truth, freedom, the conscience, what is love? And again, beyond the objective definitions, which we start with because they're true, more of the subjective in the sense that not that we define them because we define the objective truth, but what does it mean to me? And we shouldn't be afraid as Christians to address both and. Mm-hmm. In other words, the objective truth of who God has revealed himself to be, mm-hmm. but at the same time, our unique encounter with him. So what was special about this was this dialogue. It was a dialogue that we had in conversation, mm-hmm. as opposed to, you know, here's Catechism 664,
right.
Which is great. It has a place.
Yes.
But what was unique about this was we, from our own experiences, and I think we were blown here from the three of the four winds, right? from Washington, New Jersey, and from Portland, Oregon, from Deacon Harold, and to come here and to dialogue from our experience, our education, our work that we do about how we can make this appeal. How we can make this appealing as well to the culture about what we truly want, mm-hmm. as opposed to what's imposed on by assenting to a particular belief. What is it that we long for and we yearn for? And how do we satisfy that deepest longing of our heart for love, for communion, for belonging, for fulfillment? And those things that are offered as counterfeit from the culture, we can wag fingers at the offerings, the counterfeits and solutions, but we need to affirm what's affirmable in terms of what people and human persons universally long for.
Okay.
So that dialogue that we've been having, the conversation we've been having, has been one that I think has been a rich viewpoint to some of these big and difficult topics.
It sounds like the kind of dynamic of, you know, affirming what the deepest longings of people, not the superficial ones.
Right.
Along the lines of St. Augustine in his Confessions, doing the same thing, you know, that ultimately find that the deepest longing is for God.
That's our hope. Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Deacon Harold, it is so good to have you back.
It's great to be back.
Yeah.
My professor.
I don't know if you know, Deacon Harold is one of my, when I corrected his papers, I always saved them for last because they were my dessert. They were dessert. The only problem with his papers is he had longer footnotes than he did text. But Deacon Harold, what did you contribute to this besides footnotes?
Well, what I loved about this is when Gloria contacted me about being part of this, I was very excited. I met Gloria some time ago in Indianapolis, and she gave one of the best pro-life talks I have ever heard. I mean, literally, Father, I was mesmerized. And I said to myself, I have got to introduce myself to her. And so we met and we became friends and we stayed in contact over the years. And she seen me here on the network. And when she brought this idea about the series and outlined it, I got so excited. I was honored, actually,
sure.
to be asked to participate in this. And from my perspective then, we have a female perspective. We have the male perspective, we have the ordained ministry perspective.
So to remind folks that you're an ordained deacon in the Catholic
deacon.
Church. So
yes.
You've got that perspective of being part of the clerical state.
That's correct. And so I bring a little bit of the theology and the pastoral application piece to our discussion and conversation, because a lot of things that we've talked about, I've encountered. People have come to me or at talks or in the parish, and we've talked seriously and deeply about these issues. Mm-hmm. And so it's like the viewer is like a fly on the wall, listening to this really exciting, dynamic exchange between the three of us, which has a wonderful balance of intellectual rigor, but at the same time, very pastoral application. And Damien even broke into song. At one point, man, we were filming,
and
he started
singing. Right.
It was awesome.
Yes, he did.
It was awesome, and I felt so relaxed, because usually this is my fourth series now on the network. And I mean, I love coming here. I love doing the shows. But there's a little bit of nervousness because it's just you and the camera. But here, it's just, you know, you get a little, you feel a little relaxed. I mean, you prepare. We all prepare.
Right.
But it was something, not having notes and just talking and riffing off each other, almost like musicians. Uh-huh. You know, you listen to the cue from one musician, you take your cue from the other one.
Sure,
it was,
sure.
It was wonderful.
Yeah, that's great. Now, one of the things that people are going to want to know, mm-hmm, is, you know, we obviously live in a culture that is moving strongly towards a relativism.
Oh, yes.
And you are not very relativistic in all this.
No, not at all. we actually talk about that. You often hear, well, that's not my truth. This is, you can say that, but that's not my truth. And if you think about it, that's ridiculous. There's such a thing as objective truth. So we address things like people not understanding the nuptial meaning of the body.
What do you mean by nuptial meaning of the body?
The total self-gift, the giving of one person to the other, and that can only happen because we are body persons, mm-hmm, male specifically, and female. And you can only give to each other in that way as male and female body persons. I'm wondering if that's a little clearer if I...
Well, it's it gets to communion. So the question of not being created for solitude, and so getting to some of the theology of the body, language and approach, but it's a recognition that we can read the physical world, in particular the body, as a sign, as an icon, to reveal deep, intimate truths, not only about who we are as a revelation, but actually a revelation of the God in whose image and likeness we're made. Mm-hmm. So this nuptial meaning of the body is getting at this idea that we are made for, I am yours, you are mine, we're not meant for solitude. Mm-hmm.
And so we have to address those basic things, just the basic understanding of the human person, because you see right now in the culture so much as, well, that's what you may think, but that's not the truth. Or people want to redefine marriage as if marriage is something that could be redefined. And so we talk about those very difficult topics clearly from the perspective of believers, but also from looking at reality. You can't change what is truly in front of you. You just have to recognize it and say, okay, what does this mean? And go from there. So we do have relativistic culture, but that's a part of the problem. Mm-hmm. And we hope that we give people the understanding of how to recognize truth and then to ask themselves, so what does that mean?
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things that I think we deal with in the Catholic Church in America, and I think in other countries too, is that on one hand, we want to be part of the culture and make an impact on the culture.
Yes, yes.
On the other hand, we are tempted to agree with the culture in ways that are, we don't keep our own identity as Catholics clear enough. I just heard on my radio show this afternoon that there's an archbishop who's saying that he agrees with his societies, he's not from the States, but he agrees with them having same-sex unions. And he put it in those terms that he wants to agree with his government's laws on that. And you are challenging us to say, no, we stand over against the culture based on certain principles.
And not just the what's. I completely agree. It's not just the what's, but in 13 episodes, we're able to get into the why's behind the what's.
Yes.
And
exactly.
In that sense, there's an appeal.
Yeah, exactly.
There's
yes.
a compelling reason mm-hmm. that doesn't require first an assent of belief. Mm-hmm. It's one thing to speak as believers and to talk to each other in the language we understand mm-hmm. and to speak about as in our trust of Mother Church, and that's beautiful. But in terms of evangelism, we should have the ease as well to mm-hmm. speak without requiring that assent of belief. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, it's an appeal to human experience. Mm-hmm. Not that it defines what's true, but it reveals what it is, the good, the bad, and the ugly. You know, mm-hmm. when we have a bad experience or a good experience, it's meant to affirm or to give life to what's true. So what we've done, I believe, well, hopefully in this conversation on the series, is to show and to look at the culture. We're in it as well. Mm-hmm. But not being of it, we can say, you know what, that looks good, but that sounds good. but it's not good and sound, right? And people say, yeah, you know, that doesn't deliver in what we think that it does. And being able to discern that is not a matter of having a series of beliefs. It really is laying that foundation. Who are we? Who are we as human persons made in God's image and likeness? Mm-hmm. And from that then, how do we live to be truly happy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. And in practically applying that, we talk about natural law. Mm-hmm. And so we put it in its proper order, God's eternal law, his inner intelligibility, the law that God used to create the stars, the moon, the universe. And we can't touch that. But beneath that is the divine law. It's that part of God's eternal law which has been revealed to us. And that was revealed to us fully in the person of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Then there's the natural law.
Well, what kind of conclusion did you come up with that?
See about the footnotes?
And then we have the natural law, which is that part of God's eternal law, which is in place on the hearts of every single human person.
Right.
The fundamental principle of which is do good and avoid evil. We can come to know the truth of who God is by reason alone. And I showed this practically. I mean, I was asked to go to Singapore, and they said, we want you to give a talk on marriage and family life, but you can't talk about Jesus. And I said, huh? And they said, well, you know, it's a public talk, and we have rules here, and plus most of your audience are Hindus, Buddhists, and Muslims. And so talking about Jesus is not going to cut it. And so I said, well, how am I was thinking to myself, how am I going to do this? I said yes. And I said, how am I going to do this? And then I said, natural law. And so I went over there and gave the talk, packed auditorium, and it was very well received. Because those fundamental principles, as Damon was so beautifully saying, about who we are recognized within that natural law. And then from that flows the positive or human law. Laws that flow from the natural law that we apply to everyone across cultures, regions, countries. For example, seatbelt laws. Everybody has to wear a seatbelt because it's safer for everybody to wear seatbelts rather than, you know, get to an accident and get injured. So that's the kind of practical approach that we bring to the series as well.
Sure.
And we look, one episode in particular, which I think was really fun to do, was Radical Love of Womanhood, was the title of it, where we contrasted society's view of women versus the church's view. And I think when you see that episode.
Let me just ask you to encapsulate that. How would you summarize what society is trying to say about women?
I think society is saying to women, you are defective. And in order for you to be fully free, you need to suppress your natural fertility with medicine. And if that doesn't work, we have to have surgery to fix us, abortion. So that is how it encapsulated. That's what society's view is of women. They think we are basically defective because we are female and we have the ability to bear children, which is seen as a problem and something that holds us back from reaching our full abilities as women. Mm-hmm.
And when they look at women from the church's view, from the society looking at the church, there's two ends of the spectrum. On one end, well, look, see that church, that hierarchy won't allow women to be priests? It's not fair. If women become doctors and lawyers and CEOs of companies, why can't they become priests in the Catholic Church? And on the other side, they look at, see how they worship the Blessed Virgin Mary? You know, she was home and pregnant and, you know, a mom, and, you know, that's not, you know, that's all they want women to do is be home and be pregnant all the time. So we said, oh, so we laid it out kind of just like that.
Yeah.
And we said, okay, let's get into this now.
Yeah.
And we had the discussion back and forth about how society views us, and then we said, well, wait a minute. You know, we can't keep being on defense in the Catholic Church.
No.
You know, we can't just keep saying, everybody attack us and we issue a press release. We gotta be done with that. We need to show people the richness and beauty and truth of our holy Catholic faith, the faith that, like St. Ambrose stood up for and was willing to die for before he would deny the Catholic faith.
And I think it's important for the world, the viewers, to see actually a woman, an African-American woman, saying what the church says about women is what's truly beautiful and respectful and loving and free, mm-hmm. versus what society really says. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping just my personal witness speaking that out makes people think. It's one thing to hear two men say it, it's another to hear a woman mm-hmm. say it, I mm-hmm. think.
Sure, sure. And again, a woman who's got now the experience of being a mom.
Yes.
You've got a really adorable little girl.
I love her. Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
She's so sweet. She's
As a matter of fact, all three of you are parents.
Yes.
And so you all that's another perspective that you bring to this, because you two aren't just a bunch of grouchy two guys sitting in the balcony complaining about the Muppets.
Not yet. But not yet.
but you have wives and children that you also give yourselves to, yeah. And are living this out. So the yes. three of you have, you know, this family experience.
And I think that came to bear in our discussions about the family, the domestic church, and why having a mother and a father is important, because together we image the inner life of the Trinity in a family. And for the child to be brought up and being prepared actually from childhood for marriage or either for a religious vocation, the family is that original educator for right. that. And so we talk about why it's important to have a mother and a father in a family, which is something that's under attack very much today in our society. And so we sort of go through that, and I think having perspectives as parents helped us with that a great deal.
And you know, obviously none of us are unscathed by the culture. So infused in the conversation was this sense and familiarity both with the broader culture and the culture of our faith. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't this sort of looking over the fence and caricaturing the world or caricaturing the church. It was remembering and bringing to bear our own experiences of both good, the bad, the ugly, the brokenness, and the joy, and saying, yeah, you know, this is what I bought into, this is what I thought, but this is what I found out. Mm-hmm. So there's an authenticity, just in yeah. the title, Authentically Free at Last. Mm-hmm. I think there's an authenticity that says, what we're speaking about here is something we've lived. Mm-hmm. It's not something that's mm-hmm. abstract or separate from us.
Right, right, right.
And there's a very deep personal dimension. I mean, we shared some, you know, for me, I'm just being able to talk about my mom. So when we talked about the meaning of suffering, yeah. I talked about what it was like to help my mom for the 3 years she lived with us when she was disabled in the wheelchair and on oxygen all the time, and then when she died and what that was like, and then how the Blessed Mother helped me in the healing process for that, and how sure. my relationship with her has deepened and strengthened. Mm-hmm. And we all shared yeah. stories. So there was a wonderful practical dimension drawn from the very heart of our faith into the series as well.
Mm-hmm. And we talked about infertility and the cross of infertility. And gave our own personal witnesses dealing with that. And also myself talking about what it was like when my mother was sick mm-hmm. and the graces that God gave me to be able to deal with it and understand that love means to suffer with. You don't turn away from someone that's in need. You, even though it may pain you yourself, because you love them, you go and you are with them. So I think the viewers may be a little surprised by some parts of the episodes, because it does have a very personal dimension, because we've been there.
Right, right. See, and that's going to be part of the richness of this series. Again, you're bringing this rich academic background, you know, Cornell, Brown, Berkeley, Notre Dame, and me.
You were the best part.
But you're also your personal experiences, you know, to say we as Catholics need to know who we are.
Yes.
And stand up against a culture that is not being fruitful. That's one of the things about the culture. It's not being fruitful. Right. It has these tendencies towards its own death and corruption.
Yes.
And let's face it, a lot of them were very attractive.
The glamour of evil.
If it wasn't attractive, we wouldn't be having much of a problem fighting mm-hmm. it. Yeah. So the attraction both in being able to articulate and to defend, but also to get to the mission of why we're here, I mean, yeah. to evangelize, to preach the gospel. And to preach the gospel is not, as you said, it's not defense, right? We speak about the, you know, in Ephesians 6, it's not, we're talking about things that are all in the front, you know, the helmet and the sword and the shield and the breastplate. These aren't things that, you know, on the backside where we're running away. Mm-hmm. So we're meant to be in the culture speaking and providing this gospel so people can make free decisions mm-hmm. about following our Lord. Mm-hmm. So that's not a defensive position. That's one where we are engaged in an authentic
way. Just go take that we talk about from Ephesians 6. The only part of the body that wasn't covered was the back.
That's right.
Why? Because that soldier expected other soldiers to have your back.
Mm.
You see? And so we, as a church, we are in this together. We are part of the body of Christ. Yeah. And we talked about that on the series, how the culture turns toward itself.
Yes.
And away from this communal aspect, this mm-hmm. ecclesial aspect. And that's so important for understanding who we are as a church.
Well, that's one of the key elements of relativism, mm-hmm. where if I have my truth and you have your truth yeah. and we'll all get along, that is the goal that they're trying to have, mm-hmm. that we'll all just sort of get along accepting everybody else's truth. Right. However, eventually you have to discuss how to resolve differences of what you do to act. Mm-hmm. And the ultimate weapon in a relativistic culture is that might makes right.
Yes.
The one who's the strongest mm-hmm. beats up on everybody else and gets his or her way. Mm-hmm. And you're saying we've got to go back to principles.
Absolutely. And you gave such a good example, Father, because if you look at even the discussion of redefining marriage, the language that is used to portray the church as hateful, homophobic, all these things. If you think about it, it's a way to beat you down right. By saying you're on the wrong side. And they use this language to intimidate and to paint us in, as villains, really. And so people buy that instead of looking at, well, what is it the church really says and why? Why do they say that? And so we're already seeing that today, particularly around the discussion of redefining marriage.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, it's, exactly. And just in terms of that, what are some of the ways that they're trying to redefine marriage, and what is your response?
Well, clearly, the foundation is that it's this radical individualism. It's a radical sense that I determine, based on my own preferences, my own sensibilities, my own sensuality, what I deem to be good. So my relationships, the things that I pursue, what I choose to determine to be good, is based on a radical, at its root, really, an individual in isolation. And if you follow that down to the understanding of who we are, you see that it is a radical difference from the concepts of the human person. Who are we? And the sense that we are made to be in communion with others, in relation with others, not as something that we just do. It's who we are. Mm-hmm. So there's a really an ontology, if you want to use big words, right? It's about our being. Mm-hmm. It's an anthropology. It's where with the origin of the human person. So when we speak about things, that defining of relation and being in relation and all the different forms of that is an understanding of what it means to be a person. So marriage flows from, rightly, the understanding of what does it mean to be made male and female. Mm-hmm. Masculinity and femininity, as we talked about this nuptial meaning of the body, mm-hmm. they point one to the other. Mm-hmm. And the sense is that from the very beginning, we were created to be in communion, not always in sexual communion, mm-hmm. in the sense of marriage, but following that perfection, what does it mean then that it's even possible that two persons can become one? And not just a union of bodies, a union of wills, a union of spirit, emotion, of persons, of who we are. Marriage becomes this icon, this ideal, this image of what it means to be in communion with others. So we hold up marriage as an ideal to the world that says our desire mm-hmm. and our creation to be in communion has an earthly ideal here. And it's iconized in this union of a man and a woman. And the fact that union of a man and a woman is even capable of creating a third mm-hmm. that never existed before that could live eternally, not by obligation, not even by requirement, but that it's possible, we stand in awe of marriage and hold it up as an icon for the culture.
And redefining marriage really neuters the meaning of what it means to be male and what it means to be female and what it means to be parents. It makes no sense in face of reality, biological as well. I mean, my body makes no sense without male. And I think we quoted James Brown, his song, "It's a man's world, but it means nothing without a woman or a girl." I mean, how clear can you get?
That was you. You brought James Brown.
I like that.
Well, fundamentally, we speak about redefinition. We're saying
yes,
all of them.
Go.
We hit a few of them. But that without that union, you can't have marriage.
Yes.
Without union, there's no marriage. So redefining simply says that what you're calling marriage isn't marriage because it's not possible to have that complementary union.
Right, right, right. And that's, you know, it's a complementarity that brings about a wholeness.
Yes.
And it doesn't happen overnight. It's not just something that happens on a honeymoon. Right. It is a lifelong process.
Yeah, one more perspective from natural law. You know, sometimes people come up to me and say, well, how could you be against this issue or against this? I mean, you know, you're black, remember in the 40s and the 50s, you know, what happened to your people, and now we have another people that are oppressed. And I said, well, what they're trying to fight for is a personal lifestyle choice. I say being black is not a personal lifestyle choice. It's natural law.
Right.
And so it's apples and oranges what you're talking about here, right. Trying to compare natural law to an ideology.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
And
right.
You could even compare what Dr. Martin Luther King spoke about, this very issue about justifying violating some positive laws, some civil laws, and obeying others. The letter from the Birmingham jail, he quotes St. Augustine. He says, there's unjust laws and there are just laws. And I agree with St. Augustine, who said a just law is a law that's in conformity with the natural law. Mm-hmm. An unjust law is one who is out of conformity with it. Right. And we have an obligation to fight against unjust laws. In fact, an unjust law is no law at all.
Exactly.
So the whole civil rights movement was rooted in this understanding, this connection that Deacon just did a beautiful explanation in the series of this connectedness with all of these immutable, unchangeable truths. And you can't just say, well, my strong desire, my strong want is a civil right.
Right. It's, you know, I find it, I urge everyone to, in order to understand that, read the Dred Scott decision.
Oh, yeah.
And you see how bad science, you know, led to a dismemberment of the natural law in regarding the human dignity of people because they're of African descent. And Plessy versus Ferguson, same way. You know, that this, and so what we need to do is make clear that we don't use bad science to give to undercut natural law, but we deal with natural law as a principle, and we bring it into our society. We have to go to a break, but before we do, we want to let you know about some of the other EWTN series with Deacon Harold and with Damon Owens. You can get them at Religious Catalog. One is called Behold the Man with Deacon Harold, and Embracing the Marital Gift with Damon Owens. You can contact Religious Catalog at 1-800-854-6316. That's 1-800-854-6316. Or go to www.ewtnreligiouscatalog.com and make and order those series for continued study, as well as a good prep for this new series that y'all are doing with Gloria. We're going to take a break. We'll be back in just a couple minutes, so please stay with us, and we want to get your questions for our three guests tonight. Thank you and welcome back. We are enjoying a great conversation here, but before we get back to it, I want to invite you to come down to EWTN on pilgrimage. If you, I know there'll be folks traveling back and forth, especially after the holidays, people will be traveling from the north. They make a pilgrimage down to Florida and away from the snow. And if you are coming down I-65 or I-20 or any other area around here and can stop here in Birmingham, we would love to have you as part of our studio audience and our congregation over at the chapel. You can find out information about scheduling of programs, masses, trips up to, you know, getting maps to go up to Hansville to see the sisters at the Shrine of the Most Blessed Sacrament by calling our pilgrimage department at 205-271-2966. That's 205-271-2966. Or go to our website, www.ewtn.com, and they'll help you not only with those that information, but with where you can stay in the area and, you know, some of my places to eat. We have some, I don't know if you saw the movie Fried Green Tomatoes.
No.
No, okay.
Just,
well,
I saw parts of
well, the restaurant's just down the street.
Really?
Yep, and good fried green tomatoes. Mm. Also, I want to thank some pilgrims who came here earlier this year. They're from Florida. And in the mail, they sent me a Christmas stocking.
Texas style.
It seemed kind of appropriate. I want to thank Tom and Lori Gust for sending that. They, you know, that came all the way from Florida, and it's very cool. It'll hold a lot of coal. And a big long switch, you know, because I'm that good. So thank you for this gift and some Christmas ornaments that we'll put on the tree and some delicious cookies, which we'll see what happens to us. All right. Before we, are y'all ready to get going with some questions?
Yeah, sure.
All right.
Sure.
Let's start off with Marie. Hello, Marie.
Hi, Father. How are you?
Fine. Where are you from?
Ohio.
Great. And what's your question?
Well, my question is this, and thanks for taking the call. I try to be an active Catholic without beating people over the head with it. Uh-huh. I try to gently introduce people to the ideas of faith and that sort of thing if it seems like an appropriate time. But I'm not sure how to handle people who become very assertive, aggressive, about supporting not only homosexual lifestyles, but transgendering, even among children. Oh, yeah. I've been around somebody who has a transgendered, or is considering a transgendered child. And I know that you can't change a person's DNA no matter what you do with their hormones. Right. But I'm not really sure how to winsomely or graciously answer their questions according to even natural law, because they don't want to hear about the Catholic Church because of the scandals and that sort of thing. So I'm not really sure what kind of footing to be on to defend the Church's position on that.
Oh, thank you. That is a very good question, Maria. I appreciate that.
I was just, as she was saying that, and she said it's a child, you know, if maybe you might appeal to the person by saying to them, okay, what if your child was insisting that bleach is water and that they wanted to drink bleach? You wouldn't let them make that decision because they're a child and because you know it would kill them. So why would you allow them as a child to make a decision about the reality of their bodies just because they can't grasp what it is? So maybe if you use those kinds of examples with your friend, it may draw home the point and also hopefully get across to them how very serious a change, a gender change would be for a child by comparing it to letting a child drink bleach because the child's insisting bleach is water when you know it's not.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any other reflections?
I think the key to evangelization is, as she said, not beating people over the head, is as Jesus said, the parable of the sower. You know, our job is not to change people's minds or change people's hearts because only the Holy Spirit can do that. Our job is to, first of all, not be afraid to even take a few licks, because quite frankly, Jesus said, pick up your cross and follow me. And when we do that as Catholics, we stand up for the truth of our faith. Jesus was spat on, kicked, mocked, punched, and the same thing's going to happen to us. So you got to have to expect that. But when it comes to evangelization, you just go out there, the parable sower. Some of the things you say are going to land on sandy soil, thorny soil, rocky soil. The birds are going to carry it away. Some's going to land on good soil. What happens after that seed lands and the seed of faith grows in that person's heart? The Holy Spirit gives it sunlight and fertilizer, allows that seed of faith to grow. But we can't do that. Our job is to be faithful and throw the seeds. And I see the issue that she's having because the friend doesn't see the church as credible because of the scandals. And we need to follow the lead of a man like Father Augustine Tolton, who was ostracized as a priest, as a Catholic priest, because he was black.
He was the first black priest ordained in the United States.
Yeah, and they were saying things like, because he welcomed white, black, anybody to come to Mass at his parish. But the other priests were saying, if you go to Mass at his parish, it doesn't count as your Sunday obligation. So people say, well, why did he stay in the church? Because he recognized that even though the people in the church that are supposed to represent the church are sinful, the teachings are still true, good, and beautiful. And that's what he focused on. Right. See? And I think that needs to be your point, to focus on the things that are true, good, and beautiful, and recognize, you know, my arguments are not going to change their mind. If I just have the best argument, then they'll change. You know, you just have to throw the seeds and not be afraid to do that and let the Holy Spirit take it from there.
But I do think there's also appealing to reason.
Yes,
in terms
absolutely.
Of with this woman and with the child. And also, we cannot underestimate the power of prayer. Mm-hmm. Also in helping you to cope with when you see these painful things happening, and also for that child and for that parent. And we know prayer is powerful. Maybe even having a mass offered for the child and for the parent, I think, would also be very helpful in a situation.
Sure, sure. And, you know, in terms, I would address the issue of the scandals. You know, it is not church teaching.
That's right.
Right.
To go ahead and abuse children. Mm-hmm. That is against natural law and church law.
Yes.
And that those who perpetrated that were going against yes. church teaching.
Yeah.
And so, and those who didn't either know how to discipline them or protect children, or who refused for whatever, I mean, it's all complicated when you get to the concrete, but about those who didn't protect, you know, in the leadership. But, you know, that also is not part of church teaching. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, the church does not promote it. And it was a series of horrendous activities done by 1.6% of the clergy. And to use that as a way to undercut the 98.4% of what the clergy are trying to teach is not good sense. Mm-hmm. You know, what we have to make sure that we do is that we don't allow the sinners to nullify the good and, you know, and say, well, they're sinners, so we can't do it. No. Again, we've got a bigger percentage of Americans who held to segregation and bigotry for a longer period of time, and it wasn't corrected for a long time. And does that mean that our Constitution is evil? No, no. It means that we have to learn to apply the Constitution, you know, correctly, and the Declaration. And this is the same thing with Catholic thought. Mm-hmm. You know, don't let the sinners nullify it. That's very
exactly
important.
Right.
We have another caller on the line. Hello, Troy.
Yes, hi. How are you tonight?
Fine, thanks. Where are you from?
Littleton, Colorado.
Great. And what is your question?
Well, I work in a very scientific environment, and just want to know maybe how y'all feel that I can approach my coworkers and colleagues with the things of God without interrupting the environment, and yet still being purposeful with my evangelism.
Yeah, well, I'll speak as a recovering engineer. You know, before before all this great work in the last 10 years or so, full time, bachelor's, master's, 15 years engineer. I love science,
yeah.
And one of the beautiful things about science, whether it's in the formation of things in engineering or the underlying physics or biology, is the integrity. We talked about wholeness and an integral wholeness in both the physical world and its capacity to express deep spiritual mysteries, including the mystery of God Himself. And one of the most attractive things is not so much the ideas and the concepts and maybe that intellectual grasping to convert folks, but it's a wonder and an awe. You know, wonder, awe, beauty, mm-hmm. and truth mm-hmm. is so attractive. And as in the prior caller, in this challenge of evangelism, of being pastoral, but also of being present, being ready to speak the truth and to preach the truth, but at the same time, being in authentic relation to have the credibility to do it. And in your work environment, it's unusual to have that opportunity to speak directly on doctrinal issues, and it may not always be the best way to do it. I think nurturing a natural awe and wonder that, I believe it was Pope Benedict that said, reverence, and our reverence before the Lord, what is it but a more mature form of awe, wonder, and fascination? Mm-hmm. So there's a childlike wonder about the created world that is attractive, even when you drill down to some of the most, the details of some of the latest scientific discoveries. So my recommendation would be cultivate that awe and that wonder, because at some point the question is going to be, how did this get to be so wonderful? Mm-hmm. And the sincerity and the joy and the knowledge that there was a creator, a deliberate creator of this world, all to serve him through the human person in dominion, is something that will shine through.
I didn't work in a scientific environment, but I worked in finance for many years. And I found that going to Mass on Ash Wednesday and coming to work with those ashes on my forehead always brought up conversation. Sometimes I get mocked, which gave me a good chance to evangelize, or people just ask the question. So sometimes just living the faith, particularly in those days where, well, Ash Wednesday is one big one where you have the ashes on your forehead, I can guarantee you, you'll get some kind of comments or looks or something that will invite conversation. Not from you bringing it to them, but them bringing it to you.
Right.
So
and I think that's key, drawing people into the conversation.
Sure.
So even simple things like if you're going to lunch, praying before you eat.
Oh, yes.
Yep. Something simple like that. In your cubicle or your office, have a little desktop crucifix there.
Yes.
You know? And so you just draw people, or you pray before you eat. Or maybe just you have a little rosary in your hand while you're doing your work or something, or maybe listening to EWTN radio on your computer.
Oh, you know, man.
And people, what are you listening to? I mean, see how you're drawing people into the conversation, and then that way it's not threatening because they're the ones asking the questions.
Right. I think there's a naturalness that's critical. There's a naturalness in how we live our lives. It's not as if we're walking around, you know, with a crown of thorns on our head or with
huge crucifix. Well, like the first caller said, you don't want to beat people over the head.
Right.
We don't want to do it, and nobody wants it to be done to them.
Right.
But the naturalness combined with a beautiful and a credible competency in work.
Oh, yes.
Right.
Yes.
If you are excellent at what you do, people want to know how you do it. If you're the best in finance, if you're this incredible scientist, and now you have a platform in your excellence in your work that, God willing, you've offered as a sanctification, right? Mm-hmm. And you've offered as a means not only to sanctify yourself, to sanctify others. So your work becomes an occasion where you build the credibility so that when you turn to somebody and say, that's created, they go, whoa. Right. That's as opposed to the guy who, you know, doesn't do your work very well, sloppy this, and you're not very good at this, and you say, God is good. And they're like, oh, thanks, good, okay. So I think there's a naturalness in both our faith integrated to us, but also a credibility that grows from an excellence in the secular activities that we do.
You know, and one of the things, Troy, I want to recommend, two guests I've had on the program in the past, Father Robert Spitzer, S.J., and Dr. Anthony Rizzi, who is a physicist. Look them up on the internet, and they will also give you a lot of more specifics than we've done today about science as such, but give you lots of great things to interact with scientists. Let's go to Joan. Hello, Joan.
Hi, Father. How are you tonight?
Fine. Where are you from?
I'm from Pennsylvania.
Great.
And this is a wonderful show.
Thank you.
I teach seniors in high school, and I use Theology of the Body book, and they really seem to listen, enjoy, discuss. But when it comes to the challenges that you talked about this evening, especially the attractiveness of the secular world and how they are immersed into technology, they clam up. They don't want to talk about those challenges, and I cannot prove it, but I know many of them are drawn into things perhaps they don't want to talk about. My question is this. I'm very impressed with your series, both personally and spiritually, and I'm wondering if I purchased this series, would it help them break through some of the silence that occurs in the classroom when we talk about same-sex marriages or we talk about other issues, fornication, and the things that come out in the book that I'm using? They don't want to talk about those things. And I'm always looking for other resources.
Well, I think showing them when the series does come out, being able to show that to the children with their parents' permission, of course, it allows them to talk about the issue without identifying any behaviors they may or may not do, which I think is what would be important. And we bring those things up and we break it open.
Yes.
Among the three of us. So also allowing the kids to react to what we've said, I think, is a way to get them to talk about it without necessarily meaning that they themselves have engaged in any of these behaviors.
And just so we clarify something Gloria said, this series is not ready yet. They just finished filming it today.
Yes.
So there's going to be some editing process, and then we're going to broadcast it on EWTN. But when it is available, it'll be a great source.
I actually give a little bit of insight. I'm one of the national trainers for the Theology Body for Teens program that she's referring to. And that program does, as intended, in at home, as a parents program, as a youth group, youth ministry, classroom, after school. It's a program that's intended to introduce these foundational principles of what is love, how are we created, and then to have the ability, similarly, to get into some of the specific ethical and moral questions as well. It's important to recognize that I know that she does, Joan does as a teacher, is that our influence as this, you know, the outer rings of that principle of subsidiarity, right, from the family and the formation of a person, that we're meant to support these closer structures, particularly the family and the parents, in the formation of the children. So in that sense, it's not we're not advocating, we're not stepping back, but we're saying we can't replace, even if we wanted to, which we hope we don't, you know, the rightful role of parents in forming these young people and their young people. So we provide these principles for them to propose to them, for them to start working out. And I'm not so sure, I'm not convinced, honestly, that the immediate interaction of a high school senior, junior, sophomore who's introduced to these ideas is the right sign and indicator that it's been successful. In other words, it's enough years in 15, 16, 17 years for someone to have experienced so much that by the time they hear the truth, they clam up because there's an awe, there is a shame, there's a depth of that. Right. So my point is to keep going, keep doing, let the Lord do what he's gonna do. And our series, I think, can help you maybe as a secondary source in entering, reaffirming some of the principles for them to work some of that out. But keep introducing these and trust that the Holy Spirit will provide for them a means to discern.
Okay, let's go to another call. We have Tony on the line. Hello, Tony. Tony, you there?
Hi, Father. How are you?
Fine, thank you, sir. And where are you from?
Texas.
Great. And your question?
I have a couple of teenage sons that I'm having some issues with, just with drugs and language, music, kind of all their aspects of their life. And I'm divorced, and my ex-wife does not agree with me at all on what, you know, how to. So I'm kind of like in a dilemma as to what to do to get them to go to church, and I don't want to force them, but you know, you can't do that. So I'm just trying to figure out. Just need some help, you know.
Sure. How old are they?
15 and 17.
Yeah. It's tough to force a 17-year-old to do that. Any response in our last few minutes?
Well, I know as a father, seven daughters and one. In fact, my daughter Leah is here with us in the audience here. The challenge is forming both in the actual deliberate teaching of our young people and also in and through our own example. Mm-hmm. So without casting any rebuke, not knowing any of the details, I get the calls that come through, I know that our fatherhood is one that is meant to be taught by example. As much, if not more, than particular teachings that we would have in a moment. So model the faith. Let them see you pray. Mm-hmm. Deacon spoke about that in one of the series of letting our children watch us pray and mm-hmm. submit ourselves to God, being open and transparent about both our faith, our struggle in the faith, our growth, and really modeling what it means to be a man building relationships. And
we have about a minute or so left, but do you have any
guys, we often underestimate the power of the culture. And what the culture has done is blinded our children to the truth. And we have to help them uncover the truth so they can start, uncover the lie so they can start to love the truth. For example, not going to Mass. You know, it's boring. They don't understand why they're there. What we need to do is to provide the proper perspective in catechesis so they can understand the why of their faith and not just the what. What's going to make them want to go to Mass when they're 17, 18, 19 and they leave the house on their own and not because, well, mom and dad are not making me go anymore. Right. And those are the things that we try to get at the very root level in this series.
And I think for Tony to take what you're saying, using his example, to have a longer term perspective.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, that these kids are going to have problems because they're using drugs. Mm. Life is not going to be easier for them. Mm-hmm. and he can have himself ready to catch them in their 20s as these things start to fall apart. He can be there for them and say, look, Christ really can help you with this. You know, and this, you know, he's going to need to struggle through this until they're ready to see the difference. I'm afraid we've run out of time. We could go on for another hour easily, but we don't have another hour. We have just a few seconds. Thank you all for doing the series and for being here with us tonight. And I want to thank all of you and give you a blessing. May Almighty God bless you and keep you and cause His face to shine upon you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
In something I learned, you know, last week is that November was a very difficult month for EWTN. We did not bring in nearly enough to take care of our bills. And so we're really behind. Now, I know the economy is tough, but if all of our viewers give a little, keeping us in between your gas bill, your electric bill, and your cable bill, we'll be able to pay off some of these bills. So please help us, and God bless you for your generosity. Thank you.